Hey there, Recreators, and welcome to a special 4th of July edition of Lunch and Learn. Today's program is going to be a brief history of the American flag titled Long May It Wave. So on behalf of all of us here at Parks and Recreation, we hope that you have a safe and happy 4th of July weekend, and also happy 244th birthday, America. And now, long may it wave. Welcome to the July 2020 Lunch and Learn titled Long May It Wave, a brief history of the American flag. Now I'd like to introduce you to the reason why I do this program. For the first 21 years of my life, I was fortunate enough to be able to spend it with that lady on the left. Her name is Lyle Baskerville, and she was my great-grandmother. She had a career for many years as a telephone operator for the Bell Telephone Company in Tampa, Florida. Upon her retirement, the phone company created this program called Long May It Wave, and they gave it to her as a retirement gift to carry on the legacy of another famous employee that they had by the name of Francis Bellamy. If that name sounds familiar to you, it should. He wrote our Pledge of Allegiance. For many years after her retirement, she gave this program well over 100 times to civic groups, schools, churches, anyone who asked to see it, and she always did it free of charge. Upon her passing, the program was unfortunately lost, and this recreation is a much lighter version that is done electronically. So on her behalf, I hope that you enjoy today's program. And now let's move on with part one. This first part will introduce you to some of the terms you're going to hear throughout the entirety of this program. This will help you navigate some of the more difficult terms or things you may not have ever heard of concerning flags. The first two terms apply basically to European flags. The first being a saltier, as evidenced here by the Scottish saltier, with the cross of St. Andrew over a blue background. Any flag with an X across it is considered a saltier. The flag on the right is the current flag of England. It's called St. George's Cross, a red cross upon a white background. This flag is just simply called a cross flag. For our modern flag, there's three terms that you'll hear throughout this program. The first is called the canton. It's the upper left-hand designed portion of a flag. The rest of the flag outside of the canton is called the fly. Whenever the canton is removed from the fly, it's called a jack. This term is typically used at sea and by the U.S. Navy when they fly a smaller flag upon their ship. Here's two examples of a jack flag in use. The first is on the left-hand side aboard the USS Constitution moored in Boston, Massachusetts. The right is the USS Missouri in a photo taken during World War II. The one on the left shows 50 stars, which is the current Navy Jack in use as of 2019. The one on the right shows 48 stars, which was the correct amount of stars during World War II. These flags were typically deployed when a ship was at anchor in a harbor, most times because when you were standing on a dock looking up at a tall ship, the rigging in the sun would usually block out the flag that flew from the masthead. These smaller jack flags were flown from a pole called the jack staff at the front of the ship, so it was easy to tell for tax collectors and levyers to make sure that they were taxing the correct country for the ship that was offloading their goods. Part two of our program today will go into all of the different iterations of the American flag from the first time it was flown on our shores up to the 50-star flag that we fly today. We're going to start this section with a reading of a short poem called I Am the Flag by Ruth Apperson Rouse. I am the flag of the United States of America. I was born on June 14, 1777 in Philadelphia. There, the Continental Congress adopted my stars and stripes as the national flag of the United States of America. My 13 stripes, alternating red and white, with a union of 13 white stars on a field of blue, represented a new constellation, a new nation dedicated to the personal and religious liberty of mankind. Today, 50 stars signal from my union, one for each of the 50 sovereign states in the greatest constitutional republic the world has ever known. I am your title deed of freedom, which is yours to enjoy and hold in trust for posterity. If you fail to keep this sacred trust inviolate, if I am nullified and destroyed, you and your children will become slaves to dictators and despots. Eternal vigilance is the price of your freedom. As you see me silhouetted against the peaceful skies of my country, remind yourself that I am the flag of your country, that I stand for what you are, no more and no less. Guard me well, lest your freedom perish from the earth. Dedicate your lives to those principles for which I stand, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I was created in freedom. I made my first appearance in the greatest battle for human liberty ever seen on the face of the earth. God grant that I may spend eternity in my land of the free and the home of the brave, and that I shall ever be known as Old Glory, the flag of the United States of America. The first flag we'll discuss is called the British Union Flag, also known as the King's Colors. This flag is likely what flew when the Pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock in 1620. It was created by King James IV when he succeeded Elizabeth I to the English throne. 3 years after becoming king, he needed to unify Scotland and England into one country. He took the Red Cross of St. George and combined it with the White Cross of St. Andrew, putting the flags of both England and Scotland together superimposed on top of each other. The Union flag was not received well by the English or the Scottish. Neither appreciated having their flags overlapped onto one flag. The next flag we'll discuss is the British Red Ensign. This is also known as the Red Meteor Flag, or the Meteor Flag of Old England. This flag became the basis for almost every flag designed during the Revolutionary War. In 1707, Queen Anne developed this flag to better identify vessels at sea, to differentiate between merchant vessels, government vessels, and military vessels. The flag was changed to red, white, and blue depending on the designation, and the king's colors were in the upper left corner as a canton. The red ensign was the banner of British troops who opposed Washington's Continental Army all throughout the Revolutionary War, and it was under this flag that General Cornwallis surrendered to Washington at Yorktown in 1781. The military version of this flag was later changed to be a St. George's Cross with a Union Jack canton, and it is still used by the British Navy today. In the early part of the Revolution, a group known as the Sons of Liberty dismantled a British Red Ensign flag by removing the King's colors from the canton and sewing white stripes, at first vertical and then horizontal later on, to signify their rebellion against England. The first flag had 9 stripes for the first 9 colonies that agreed to rebellion. Later on, all 13 colonies would join in, and 13 stripes would be created. These Sons of Liberty flags both flew at different times above places where the Sons of Liberty met. After the Revolution started, these became known as the Rebellious Stripes. The 13-stripe version of this is likely the first Navy Jack, but historians disagree on the facts to officially declare it so. These unique flags are called the Liberty Tree flags, and sometimes called the Washington's Cruiser's Flags. Rear Admiral David Henry Preble recounts the story of this famous tree and these flags in his book Our Flag and Her History. He says, "The old Liberty Tree in Boston was the largest of a grove of beautiful elms that stood in Hanover Square at the corner of Orange and Essex Streets. It received the name of the Liberty Tree from an association called the Sons of Liberty, who would hold their meetings under it during the summer of 1765. The ground under it was called Liberty Hall. A pole was fastened to its trunk and rose far above its branching top. From there, a red flag with white stripes was thrown to the breeze as a signal for the people nearby to know a meeting of the Sons of Liberty was happening. Here they held many notable meetings, and also underneath the tree they posted placards and banners suspended from the limbs or affixed to the tree itself. Following the repeal of the Stamp Act and the Boston Tea Party event, the British cut down this tree and made it a rallying symbol for the colonists. Early in the Revolutionary War, there were several variants of these Liberty Tree flags. These two are the most common. The name Washington's Cruisers comes from when George Washington fashioned a small navy together to defend Boston Harbor shortly after the Battle of Bunker Hill." That leads us to the next two flags on our list, the Bunker Hill flags. These were allegedly carried by colonists at the Battle of Bunker Hill, which was the second engagement of the Revolutionary War. The first version has a red fly with a white canton, showing a New England pine tree in the center. The pine tree was a common symbol representing liberty in colonial New England. The second is a blue fly with a St. George's Cross canton and a New England pine tree in the corner of the cross. This flag was based on the British blue ensign, which was flown on British merchant ships at the time. Historians are not sure these flags truly appeared at Bunker Hill, as there are no verified accounts of their presence. The British technically won this battle by taking the peninsula around Boston, but it was a huge blow to their military superiority. They lost nearly one-third of their men, and the supposedly ragtag colonists demonstrated they were not afraid to fight off their British oppressors. Some historians believe this flag was made as a mockery of the traditional red ensign to enrage the British soldiers that occupied Boston, and a mockery of the blue ensign by placing a pine tree in St. George's Cross. This flag is the first of many that would deface the British red ensign throughout the war. This next flag, the Huntington Liberty flag, was created in 1776. In Huntington, Long Island, when the Declaration of Independence was read, they took down their British red ensign and removed the side that said George III, and they removed the canton from the corner. They then stuffed that into an effigy of King George III, and they burned it in the town square. This flag was carried into the Battle of Long Island by the Suffolk County Militia, about 300 men, going into battle against 15,000 British and Hessian soldiers. At the end of the battle, this flag was captured by the Hessians and returned to Austria, where it stayed in a museum in Germany until an Allied bombing raid in World War II destroyed the museum and the flag. Our next flag is the First Navy Jack, sometimes called the Culpeper flag. This is an adaptation of the Sons of Liberty rebellious stripes, but with a rattlesnake featured at center and the words "Don't tread on me" at the bottom. This was an indication that the colonists would not be afraid to strike back, just like a rattlesnake would, if harassed. It was believed this flag first flew aboard the USS Alfred, the flagship of the newly commissioned Continental Fleet, in January of 1776. American ships used this flag, or one of its variations, all throughout the Revolutionary War. This flag was used as the modern Navy Jack all the way up until 2019, where the Jack was then replaced with a field of blue and 50 stars, the canton of our current 50-star flag. The rattlesnake was a powerful American symbol used by the Navy in 1776, and still is used in places to this day. This next unique flag, called the Gadsden flag, was created by South Carolina Congressman Christopher Gadsden for Commodore Essex Hopkins, who was at the time the commander of the new U.S. Navy. This flag features a yellow field with the rattlesnake symbol once again and the words "Don't tread on me" at the bottom. It was created because Congressman Gadsden felt like the First Navy Jack, while it was a great flag, was not visible enough on the high seas, so he had commissioned this large yellow flag that Commodore Hopkins would display on his ship. This is also the very first flag of the United States Marine Corps. The story goes that the U.S. Navy's first mission took them to the Bahamas to capture a British ammunition and gunpowder depot that was stored there. Commodore Hopkins, with his sailors and Marines, captured Fort Nassau at the Battle of Nassau in what was called a bloodless victory. This means the first flag carried into battle by the United States Marines and the first amphibious assault conducted by the U.S. Navy were both carried out under the Gadsden flag. As you can see, there have been several variations on the flag up until this point, which was prior to the reading of the Declaration of Independence. Finally, George Washington convened with three other men at his headquarters in Cambridge, Massachusetts, to decide on one common flag that would be used for all of the armed forces of the United States. He says, "The necessity of a common national flag seems not to have been thought of until Dr. Franklin, which is Benjamin Franklin, Mr. Lynch, and Mr. Harrison were appointed to consider the subject, and assembled at my camp at Cambridge. The result of their conference was the retention of the king's colors, representing the still recognized sovereignty of England, but coupled to 13 stripes, alternate red and white, emblematic of the union of the 13 colonies against its tyranny and oppression, in place of the loyal red ensign." This flag was commissioned on the 2nd of January, 1776, and again, the four men responsible for creating it were George Washington, Benjamin Franklin, Virginian Benjamin Harrison, and South Carolinian Thomas Lynch. This flag was called the Continental Colors. Though this flag is not a national flag of the United States, it's worth mentioning because the design played an important role in the future design of the flag that we use today. This is George Washington's personal banner, 13 six-pointed stars on a field of blue. This flag went with Washington everywhere he went during the Revolutionary War, very much like in the old days when knights would take the field of battle against other knights and kingdoms in the medieval period. They would fly banners so each knight knew which other knight was on the field. Washington loved that idea and used this banner everywhere he went. The British knew it, and any time they saw it, they made certain to go to that point and seek out Washington because there was a bounty on his head and he was a very important target to capture. Finally, on June 14, 1777, Congress acted by passing the Continental Flag Act. It says, "Resolved, that the flag of the United States be made of 13 stripes, alternate red and white, that the Union be 13 stars, white, in a blue field, representing a new constellation." With this declaration, they liked the Continental colors, but they removed the King's Canton from the corner and replaced it with a blue canton very similar to Washington's banner. After Congress had acted and declared what a national flag should look like, several flag makers jumped to the chance to go ahead and create their own versions for sale. One of the first reported flags made this way was the Betsy Ross flag, which is the traditional flag associated with the Revolution of the United States. It has 13 stars in a round on a field of blue with the 13 red and white stripes. History is against Miss Ross, unfortunately, that she says she made the first flag. It is likely that she did not. While it is probable that she did make flags, and she probably did make flags that looked like this, as well as several others, it is unlikely that she made the first flag at the behest of George Washington. However, if you visit the Betsy Ross House in Philadelphia, please don't go there and tell them that we told you that she did not make the first flag. They may politely ask you to leave. History is on the side, however, of Mr. Francis Hopkinson with this flag design called the Hopkinson flag. He was the only individual to actually claim credit for the design of the U.S. flag at the time. He billed Congress for a quarter cask of the public wine for his efforts. Congress did not outright deny his claim, but sat on the claim for years. Only after Hopkinson rebilled his claim in cash, along with other claims for other emblems, did Congress act on it, denying it on the grounds that Hopkinson was not the only person who had a hand in designing the flag and other emblems. However, this flag is more likely close to the first design of the very first U.S. flag. The unique design of this flag, called the Serapis flag, also has a unique story to go with it. Captain John Paul Jones of the U.S. Navy terrorized the English coastline all throughout the Revolution until a bounty was put on his head and upon his ship, the Bonham Richard. One day, while going about their raiding, the Bonham Richard ran across the HMS Serapis, a 64-gun ship of the line and a very deadly foe. These two ships went toe-to-toe, trading broadside after broadside, until neither ship was hardly able to sail. At one point in the battle, the flag that Jones flew from his masthead was shot off by a cannon. The captain of the Serapis hollered over to Jones and said, "I see you've struck your colors, sir. Are you ready to surrender?" To which Jones famously replied, "Surrender, sir? I have not yet begun to fight." At the end of the day, the crew of the Bonham Richard captured the Serapis. However, the Richard was so badly damaged it sank to the bottom of the sea. Jones took his crew aboard the Serapis and sailed it to the neutral port of Texel in the Netherlands, where the British port authorities at the time declared him a pirate and demanded that the Dutch hang him for piracy. Jones, through a sequence of events, reached out to the ambassador of Paris at the time, Mr. Benjamin Franklin, who hastily sketched this flag that you see here, sent it back to Jones, who then had the flag made, and at their trial for piracy presented it as the flag of the United States. The Dutch recognized the flag and the country and the sovereignty of the United States and allowed them free to set sail, much to the chagrin of the British. Therefore, this flag, the Serapis flag, is the very first recognized by another country for the fledgling United States. It was under the Cowpens flag, also known as the Third Maryland Colors, that General Daniel Morgan won one of the most brilliant victories of the Revolutionary War at Cowpens, South Carolina. With the help of Maryland, Virginia, and Georgia regiments, General Morgan stopped the attacking British dead in their tracks. Trapped by the cavalry and the militia, the surrounded British soon surrendered. In the film The Patriot, the final battle scene is portrayed to be the Battle of Cowpens. Mel Gibson is seen carrying the Betsy Ross flag during the battle. All they needed to do was get it relatively historically correct, was to make it a copy of the 3rd Maryland colors. This flag of the 3rd Maryland Regiment, which was actually present that day at Cowpens, is now enshrined at the state capitol in Annapolis, Maryland, in honor of that battle. This unique flag was carried by the North Carolina militia at the Battle of Guilford Courthouse in March of 1781. During that battle, General Cornwallis handed Major General Nathaniel Greene a very bitter defeat on the field, but it was a huge point in turning the favor towards the Americans. 1/3 of the British army in the southern colonies were killed at this battle. General Greene nearly captured Cornwallis himself, if not for a single terrifying order. Cornwallis ordered his artillerymen to open fire with grapeshot into the battle raging in front of him, including his own men, killing friend and foe alike. This terrible decision halted the advances of Greene's men and kept him from capturing Cornwallis. At the end of the battle, this flag was hoisted to the top of the Guilford Courthouse, even though the British took the field for the day. This was the first battle on the march to Yorktown, where the Revolutionary War, by and large, ended. I had the pleasure last year of visiting Guilford Courthouse National Military Park just outside Greenville, North Carolina. It was a fantastic trip to walk that hallowed ground and see where all of this happened. Two distinct quotes stood out to me on the trip. The first one was at the monument to General Nathaniel Greene, and it's a quote from General Cornwallis saying, "Greene is as dangerous as Washington. I never feel secure when encamped in his neighborhood." And the second quote, also from General Cornwallis, "I never saw such fighting since God made me. The Americans fought like demons." If you have the opportunity to visit the park, it is well worth the trip. The last individual flag we'll discuss in this presentation is the Trumbull flag, created by artist John Trumbull. John Trumbull was a very notable artist during the time of the Revolution, and currently has 4 paintings on display in the Capitol Rotunda in Washington, D.C. In his paintings, there is a very distinct design of this flag, called the Trumbull flag, with 6 pointed stars and a square canton with 1 single star in the middle. Mr. Trumbull created this significant painting called The Surrender of General Burgoyne at Saratoga, and if you'll look in the right-hand corner where the red circle is, you'll see the flag that's credited to him, the Trumbull flag. The only time this flag ever appears is in any of his paintings. There's no record of it ever being stitched or flown on any battle during the Revolution. Therefore, this flag is credited to him as an artistic license and was a flag that was never made, although it is declared a national flag of the United States. The Trumbull flag appears again in this painting called The Surrender at Yorktown. This depicts the final battle of the Revolutionary War and has a connection to the city of Tullahoma. The story goes that the 2 opposing generals, Lord Cornwallis for the British and Washington for the Americans, fought a very deadly battle across these shores of southern Virginia. At the end of the battle, Cornwallis was so embarrassed that he lost that he was afraid to face Washington and sent out his subordinate, another colonel in the British Army. When the colonel approached George Washington, who is depicted on the brown horse in the back underneath the flag, Washington refused to accept the sword from anyone but Cornwallis himself and waved the poor colonel to the next person in line, who happened to be French General Rochambeau. He also refused the sword and thumbed him to the next commander in line, who is that gentleman there on the white horse at the center of the painting. That man's name is General Benjamin Lincoln. He accepted the final sword of surrender for the Revolutionary War. If you've ever driven down Lincoln Street in Tullahoma, the street is not named for Abraham Lincoln, which many think, but named for Benjamin Lincoln, who accepted the final sword of surrender. Lincoln County, where Fayetteville is located, is also named for Benjamin Lincoln, though there is no historical record of him ever visiting this area that is now known as Tennessee. Our official flag has undergone many changes, the first being in 1795, after the original 13-star and 13-stripe design that you see here that was created with the Flag Act. In 1795, the additions of Vermont and Kentucky came into the Union, and the flag would go to its next iteration, which is also known as the Star-Spangled Banner. The first alteration to our flag would give us this, the 15-star and 15-stripe Star-Spangled Banner, once Vermont and Kentucky were added to the Union. When Tennessee was added as the 16th state, the flag did not change again until there were 20 states admitted to the Union, so it is likely when Tennessee became a state, the very first flag to fly here was the Star-Spangled Banner. Once the number of states got to 20, the flag was changed again, but went back to 13 stripes. Adding a stripe for each state made the flag too large. More stars, however, were added all the way up until July 4, 1960, with the addition of Hawaii that gives us the 50-star flag we recognize today. This flag shown here is the 36-star flag that flew during the U.S. Civil War from 1861 to 1865. Two states were added during the Civil War. However, the flag changes were slow to turn out. Many flags just stayed at a 36-star flag until the war was ended. This 39-star flag from 1889 is the flag that never was. Flag manufacturers believed that when the Dakotas were admitted as a state, they would come in as one state instead of two, so they manufactured this flag, some of which still exist today, but it was never an official flag. The official flag jumped from 38 stars to 40 stars. Hawaii and Alaska were not states at the time of the bombing of Pearl Harbor that drew us into World War II. That entire war would be fought under a 48-star flag shown here. This is the 50-star flag we recognize today. As of this date, the 50-star design, adopted on July 4, 1960, is the longest used version of the U.S. flag, now at 61 years. In this next section, we'll talk about two legends and stories concerning our flag. The first one, about Francis Scott Key and the national anthem, and the second is why we call it Old Glory. The 30 by 42 foot Star-Spangled Banner that resides in the Smithsonian Museum that is said to have inspired Francis Scott Key to write the national anthem may not actually be the flag that he saw from the deck of the ship after the bombardment of Fort McHenry. A terrible storm had blown through the area the day before the bombardment, and the large 30 by 42 flag would probably have been destroyed in the wind. Each garrison at the time was equipped with a storm flag, which was a smaller version, about 3 foot by 3 foot. That's actually the flag that he likely saw that inspired him to write the words. Sadly, the flag was lost to history. However, the following morning, when that flag was gone, the garrison raised the massive 30 by 42 foot banner that now resides in the Smithsonian and is called the Star-Spangled Banner. The next flag legend has a connection to Tennessee and explains why we call the flag Old Glory. The gentleman pictured here is Captain William Driver. He was a young sea captain from Salem, Massachusetts, that upon purchasing his first ship, called the Charles Doggett, a special flag was made for him with 38 stars that he would fly aboard the ship on its maiden voyage. When they raised the flag to the top of the masthead, it caught high in the breeze and the huge 17-foot banner unfurled. Captain Driver is said to have looked up and seen the flag and said, "My ship, my country, and my flag, Old Glory." Well, the name stuck, and from that point on, Captain Driver's flag was called Old Glory. After his seafaring years were over, he retired to Nashville, Tennessee shortly before the outbreak of the Civil War. During that time, Old Glory flew from a mast at his house every day, all the way up until the war started, and even after the first round of hostilities. At the time, Nashville was controlled by the Confederacy. Many in the area did not like the fact that he was displaying a Union flag and tried to take it from him on several occasions, so he decided to keep it safe and stitched it inside of a blanket. He kept it there until Union forces in 1862 came down and liberated Nashville from the Confederates. When it was liberated, Captain Driver marched to the Nashville camp of the Union general and demanded to speak to him, saying that he wanted the Confederate flag pulled down instantly and his flag raised in its place. He cut open the blanket and pulled out Old Glory. At that point, the 6th Ohio Regiment hoisted him and the flag up on their shoulders, marched him to the state capitol, and hoisted the flag up to the top. Old Glory flew from the flagpole at the Tennessee state capitol when Nashville was liberated. In 1873, before Captain Driver passed away, he gave his treasured flag to his daughter, Miss Mary Jane Rowland, who then turned around and gave it to President Warren G. Harding in 1922, after his passing. The president then took it to the Smithsonian Institution, where it remains on display to this day. Captain Driver's grave is located in the old Nashville City Cemetery and is one of the few places authorized by Act of Congress where the flag of the United States may be flown 24 hours a day. The cemetery is located at 4th Avenue South in Nashville, a little over an hour from here. In this final section, I would like to introduce you to another dear friend of mine that was a huge inspiration to continue doing this program. His name is Chief Master Sergeant Buddy McFadden from the United States Air Force. He was retired, but still went around and did his patriotic duty at several locations whenever asked, especially on holidays, where he would recruit myself and some of my Boy Scouts to come out and help him do a flag folding ceremony and a patriotic program for people who would like to see it. Sadly, Chief McFadden has passed away, but his legacy still lives on in the rest of the program that you are about to see. For more than 200 years, the American flag has been the symbol of our nation's unity, as well as a source of pride and inspiration for millions of its citizens. Born on June 14, 1777, the Second Continental Congress determined that the flag of the United States be 13 stripes, alternating between 7 red and 6 white, and that the Union be 13 stars, white, in a field of blue, representing a new constellation. The 13 horizontal stripes represent the original 13 colonies, while the stars represent the 50 states of the Union. The colors of the flag are symbolic as well. Red symbolizes hardiness and valor, white signifies purity and innocence, and blue represents vigilance, perseverance, honor, and justice. Traditionally a symbol of liberty, the American flag has carried the message of freedom and inspired Americans both at home and abroad. In 1814, Francis Scott Key was so moved at seeing the Stars and Stripes waving over Baltimore's Fort McHenry that he wrote the words to the Star-Spangled Banner. In 1892, the flag inspired Francis Bellamy to write the Pledge of Allegiance, our most famous flag salute, and patriotic oath. In 1969, the American flag was flown in space when Neil Armstrong planted it on the surface of the moon. Today, our flag flies in the heart of every patriotic American. The sun never sets on our nation, nor on the flag we so proudly cherish. By displaying this flag and giving it a distinctive fold, we show respect and express our gratitude to those individuals who fought and continue to fight for our freedom at home and abroad. The first fold of our flag is a symbol of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The second fold is a symbol of our belief in eternal life. The third fold is made in honor and remembrance of the veterans departing our ranks who gave a portion of their lives for the defense of our country to attain peace throughout the world. The fourth fold represents our weaker nature, for as American citizens trusting, it is to Him we turn to in times of peace as well as in time of war for His divine guidance. The fifth fold is a tribute to our country, for in the words of Stephen Decatur, our country, in dealing with other countries, may she always be right, but she is still our country, right or wrong. The sixth fold is for where our hearts lie. It is with our heart that we pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The seventh fold is a tribute to our armed forces, for it is through them that we protect our country and flag against all enemies, within or without the boundaries of our republic. The eighth fold is a tribute to the ones who have entered into the valley of the shadow of death so that we may see the light of day. The ninth fold is a tribute to womanhood and to the mother for whom the flag flies on Mother's Day, for it has been through their faith, love, devotion, and loyalty that the character of the men and women who have made this country great have been molded. The tenth fold is to the Father, for He too has given His sons and daughters for the defense of our country since they were first born. The 11th fold in the eyes of a Hebrew citizen represent the lower portion of the seal of King David and King Solomon, and glorify in their eyes the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The 12th fold in the eyes of a Christian citizen represent an emblem of eternity, and glorify in their eyes God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. The 13th fold completes the folding, with the stars uppermost, reminding us of our nation's motto, "In God We Trust." After the flag is completely folded and tucked in, it takes on the appearance of a cocked hat, ever reminding us of the soldiers who served under General George Washington and the sailors and Marines who served under Captain John Paul Jones, preserving for us the rights, privileges, and freedoms that we enjoy today. The flag of the United States represents who we are. It stands for the freedom we all share and the pride and patriotism we feel for our country. We cherish its legacy as a beacon of hope to one and all. Long may it wave.